Bueno, esta vez está con nosotros Boris Resnik, doctor Boris Resnik, es un colega que compartió conmigo allá en Karlsruhe, en Alemania. Él es tiene maestría en física de semiconductores, dieléctricos, cristalografía y el doctorado en física de semiconductores y dieléctricos también. No lo voy a leer todo, claro, pero solamente para que tengan una idea del trabajo que ha desarrollado él. Es investigador actualmente en el KIT, Karlsruhe Institute for Technology, en Alemania. Y también ha trabajado en institutos como tecnología de química, polímeros, microscopía electrónica, ciencias de materiales. Y bueno, ha participado también en varios proyectos de investigación apoyados por las instituciones de Alemania, como es el DFG. Y no sé si el DAAD también. Tiene una gran cantidad de publicaciones, obviamente de alto nivel, publicadas en revistas internacionales, todas enfocadas de algún modo a la cuestión mineralógica y submicroscópica. Tiene igual presentaciones en varios países, en varios congresos. Y algo importante que normalmente la gente que hace investigación no tiene, que tiene varias patentes también. De diferentes métodos de fabricación, métodos de síntesis, de diferentes tipos de materiales, es muy interesante. Creo que eso no lo tenemos acá y deberíamos de iniciar con esto. Igualmente ha sido profesor y conferencista en diferentes lugares en todo el mundo. Ha sido igual director de varias tesis de todos los niveles. Bueno, igualmente que mucha gente que es europea habla varios idiomas, entre ellos el ruso, ucraniano, el alemán, el inglés, el francés. Y cuando se vaya de aquí, espero que hable español. Ok, es un gusto, es un placer de verdad tener a Boris aquí. Y pues muchas gracias. Adelante.
Muchas gracias, Luis. First of all, yes. Thanks so much for the invitation. I'm very, very happy to be here and to share with you our recent results obtained to understand the critical processes. And you know this is very complex, and that's why we need to know different things. For example, we need to know to apply different methods like X-ray powder diffraction, electron microscopy, magnetic measurements. And maybe very short for the introduction. So where from? So you see, this is a vault. So we flew from the Karlsruhe is here somewhere at the border of the France. Yes, the Karlsruhe, the nearest big famous city is Paris. 560 kilometers. Another way, London is here. And Karlsruhe actually is a very, could be a very famous city, it's a very important city in the world, because in this city, a German engineer, Karl von Drais, invented the bicycle. And after about 60 years after, another, I don't remember the name, also engineer from Karlsruhe, invented pedals. Moreover, the father of the Mercedes-Benz car, it's a Karl Benz, was born in Karlsruhe and constructed his first car constructed by Karl Benz. And after, he constructed another car, and this car was named according to his daughter, Mercedes. Okay, now we have Mercedes-Benz. So now I go to the topic and my talk. And you know that we'd like to understand the magnetic anomalies of different crater structures in the Earth. And that's not so easy, because some craters are characterized by distinct aeromagnetic anomalies, like, for example, the crater from so-called Nördlinger Ries. This is from Germany. It's not far from Munich. And in this crater, for example, the aeromagnetic anomalies are very restricted in the center of the center of the inner rig, or the center of the impact. Another example is a crater from the Chesapeake Bay. And in this crater, we have no distinct anomalies, okay? But we know this is an impacted crater. So that's why we see this is not so straightforward. That's why we are looking for indicators, for very useful indicators. We can tell us how the impact energy is conserved with the Earth's surface and what is happening with the typical magnetic minerals. And you know, the most abundant mineral is the magnetite, is the most abundant magnetic carrier, more responsible for magnetic properties of the rocks. And that's why, again, we have two main questions, is to understand the mechanism of the impact-induced events, in particular in magnetite, on the magnetite-bearing rocks. And the next, we'd like to understand the reasons of the magnetic strain memory, how the magnetic structure correlates with structural properties and with the impact influence. And finally, if you are lucky, we can discuss which magnetic and non-magnetic properties can be used to evaluate the pressures, maybe also temperatures in the impact area. And maybe very short, what we know about the state of the art, what we know about the pressure effects in magnetite. As you can see in this slide, the most of available data originates from static loading experiments, which have been carried out using a single crystal of magnetite and using for example, most of them used diamond pressure cells on mini pressure devices. And also it was carried out in the relatively low pressure area, which is much less compared to the pressures which occurred by the natural impact of meteorite, for example. But moreover, there's a lack of information between the magnetic structural properties. Okay, this was the motivation. That's why we choose this experimental setup. We use shock recovery experiments. In these experiments, we have a holder. We have a specimen. It's a thin plate. I have with me, after talk, I can show you. It's about 15 millimeter diameter. It's a thin plate of the rock. Is placed here, and this holder is placed into the chamber container composed of the Armco iron. It's a pure iron with very famous mechanical properties. And depending on the pressure, we can use, for example, if you're below the 10 GPa, we use air gun, where the projectile is transported to the specimen, shown like here, or above the 10 GPa, we use high explosives, okay? So in this, during the explosion, this upper part of this container is deformed like a membrane, okay? It's like mechanically. It's a very established technique. And the target material originates from the Norway. And you see this, a picture of this as a macro scale. It's a magnetite-bearing ore composed of quartz and magnetite layers. You see alternating magnetite quartz areas, and the optical light microscope, you see that magnetite is present as well in the form of the layers of associations, as well as in form of single crystals, and some of the crystals have very pretty cubic shapes. So it's a very interesting to keep in mind. Again, the motivation, which method do we need to understand the impact events. And we know from the literature, okay, that during shock, we have very special pressure temperature events. And during these events, we can have fragmentation as well of the crystallites, as well of magnetic domains. And we know also that this spike temperature can be very high, that we can also expect the presence, the occurrence of melting and corresponding strain defects, et cetera, et cetera. So and if we consider the atomic structure of the magnetite, it's clear that we know we need to apply magnetic measurements. We need to apply X-ray diffraction to have access of a non-destructive characterization of the material. We need to apply electron microscopy in order to see directly the possible lattice defects. As well, we need to apply X-ray absorption near H spectroscopy, XENS, so-called XENS. And this method is especially sensitive to the stoichiometry or to the coordination medium of the iron and oxygen atoms. Okay, and here's the first result obtained by X-ray powder diffraction. Here we see the black one is a pre-shock sample, and this is with the increasing shock pressure. We see these diagrams. And the left side, the right side, sorry, we have the crystalline size, X-ray crystalline size, as a function of pressure. This is the black symbols, and we see this is not linear. It means this is the first signal that the processes occurring during the shock is not linear. There's something is changed. And similar trend we recognize in the changes of the lattice parameter presented at the right side with the blue symbols. Here we say again, here we have a very prominent drop to 10 GPa, and then we have slowly we have so-called recovery. And it's interesting that all samples from the first point of view, you can recognize all the lines of magnetite corresponds to magnetite, but we have broadening of the lines, we have shift of the lines, and that's why this is the first idea that evidently we have recovery processes. Okay, and after the shock, we can apply scanning electron microscopy. And in this case, we can learn how does it looks the shocked microstructure without a big preparation artifacts. This is the main purpose of this method. And here, for example, this is an initial sample. I just take a scene place and track by myself. We know the initially the material is very brittle, so we cannot produce a big amount of deformations. And in fact, you can recognize well-shaped cubic magnetite crystals surrounded by quartz matrix. And what we recognize, starting from 5, not shown here, but which is a representative image of the sample shocked at 10 GPa, we see a very prominent shear bands, okay, shear bands. And starting from the 20 GPa, we say that at these shear terraces, okay, it's you can imagine this area is magnified from here, but from this sample, along these sheared terraces, we have the presence of the globular grains. And this could be a hint for a possible melting phenomena. If you take into account that the melting point of magnetite is around 1,560 degrees C, so maybe we were something around in this temperature. And what is very impressive that at the highest applied temperature, we see already on the scanning electron microscope, we see the development of twinned lamella, also which can be interpreted as a indices of the plastic deformation at high pressure temperatures. Okay, and now I come back to this shortly. Now we utilize the presence of the cubic magnetite grays inside of shocked samples. How? In order to prepare samples for transmission electron microscopy. So in order to do this, we know that we selected from the powder samples cubic shaped more or less well recognizable, well oriented magnetite grains, and using a focused ion beam. So it's like a very focused beam in the scanning electron microscope, and you can cut a piece of the sample. And in this case, we cut it along this direction, okay? And in this case, we have a well-oriented sample having one direction. And this is a very prominent direction in magnetite or in cubic magnetite atomic structure. This is the direction connected with the development of plastic deformation. Okay, that's why we selected this direction. Okay, and the main purpose to be able to compare different sample under the same crystallographical conditions. Okay, this is the first results obtained by low resolution transmission electron microscopy. We see that compared to the initial unshocked sample, we see in all samples, we see the presence of the light shear bands, okay, here, here, and here. Okay, then at the higher magnification, for example, using already high resolution mode, we see, we see for the sample shocked at the 10 GPa, we see that this is the propagation of the shear bands along 111 direction. Moreover, with a more higher magnification, we see that the presence also another defects like edge dislocation, and also you can recognize the presence of so-called zigzag-like clusters or areas. Okay. And at the 20 GPa, these features are more pronounced. It appears that the shear band density is much higher, and also the development of zigzag-shaped clusters is also more evident, shown here. And also we see the presence of the dislocations. And this also evidence that evidently, we have development of twinning process. In fact, at the highest applied pressure, 30 GPa, here is a representative image of this sample. We see the presence of so-called first from the low magnification, so-called planar defects. And these planar defects, if you see, is composed of the lamella surrounded by curved areas, and using selected area diffraction in form of fast Fourier transformations, we obtained local crystallographic deformation about different parts of this defect. And we see that, for example, the central part have compared to the surrounding upper low and upper part is rotated, okay? It's shown here about 70 degrees. Is a typical twinning rotation, which are also found in magnetite obtained by synthesis, by growth in growth conditions. Okay, it's a typical crystallographic low. And here you see that, again, here is the interface, is a high magnification of this area interface between the main part, so-called main twin in surrounding matter, we hear a multi-twinning process, okay? And generally, this complex structure can be described as a king band, okay? This king band, again, we have twin, so-called matrix twin. We have first twinning, and then we have microtwins. Okay, and more of it should be underlined. So these results have very good correspondence with the results obtained by scanning electron microscopy using actually another scales, okay? So it means this result is very realistic, okay? And the next question, what has happened with the coordination states of iron and oxygen atoms? And as I said, we used X-ray absorption EH spectroscopy scans. And this in Karlsruhe, we have synchrotron source. And this source is schematically shown here. We have a very polychromatic, very power X-ray source, okay? And go in the chamber. And what is interesting is the chamber simultaneously. The studied samples is measured at, as well as the reference foil, in order to measure exactly the chemical shift. Okay? And basing on this experimental setup, it's relatively very easy to recognize the oxidation states in iron oxides. I don't show here, but as a fingerprint, you can see if we had a megamide, we will have a totally another shape of these absorption lines, only if you have a hematite, etc. Okay, but as we see here, we have no drastic changes in the oxidation state. Here is practically it's all similar, but we see that something is happened is so called pre-age, and this pre-age fine structure is shown here. As you can see, this is in this pre-age structure, we see the slight but very recognizable systematic shift of this pre-age state. And if you compare with the reference foil, here we see we have no shift. It's already at the limit of this method, but this comparison suggests that we have evident effect of shock waves on the changes of the coordination state. Okay, now, maybe shortly to summarize, we learned a lot about from the structural method about the real physical structure of the impacted samples. And now it will be more or less easy to understand and to explain the corresponding magnetic properties. So, and first of all, now you see some hysteresis parameters. For example, at the left side, we see the relationship between the remanence ratios, coercitivity ratios as a function of shock pressure. And we see that in both parameters, we have very sharp degrees or increase about 5 of 10 GPa. And then, interesting again, similar to X-ray correlations, we see the presence of some kind of recovery, okay? It's shown by red curves. And the right side, you see so-called day plot, where we have the correspondence of between the remanence and the coercitivity ratios. And we see that, first of all, the changes occurs. We have from multi-domain to the pseudo-domain state. And again, you see here very slow recovery of these parameters, indicating that we have influence of possible influence of high temperatures. Yes. Okay. Now, maybe something new. Next question is what can be else extracted from the hysteresis measurements. And actually, as Lewis was in Karlsruhe, we took an old book of Giles, Introduction to Magnetism. We find a magnetization curve where also so-called Barkhausen gems were shown. And in 1919, the Barkhausen engineer found that the induction of the sample placed into the magnetic field is not continuous. It's not continuous, but it's discontinuous in form of jumps. And this, in that time, it was the first confirmation of the magnetic theories proposed by Weiss, Peter Weiss from France, okay? It was the first confirmation of the presence of domain walls. And for example, here we have more or less reversible transformation in low fields, and in the medium fields we have most irreversible, then we have saturation, okay? So I decided to check actually this idea of what happens with our samples, because initially our samples is an interesting set of the samples. We know the pre-shock state, we know the shock state. So, and here we see first our initial magnetization hysteresis curves as a function of the pressure. What we first can recognize, we have a very evident drop of the magnetic saturation with the increasing shock pressure. Also, we have also very prominent changes in the slope of the curves, and this slope is proportional to the susceptibility of the samples. This so-called hysteresis susceptibility is similar like susceptibility extracted from thermomagnetic measurements using copper bridge analysis. So, and if you look, you can already recognize that here in the shock sample you have some jumps, okay? But it's not easy to see in this case, but it's very easy if you take first derivatives, normalizes derivatives as shown here. You see very easy, you can recognize that in the initial pre-shock sample, jumps absent in the initial low field area, as should be, okay, because the sample is have a very good crystallization state, multi-domain, okay, not different. But with increasing energy, we have some changes. But these changes are enormous, large in the case of shock samples, especially in the shock of the sample shock on the 30 GPa. Okay, and then we propose to describe the whole magnetization process with the help of three distinctive magnetization regions. And these are shown here, schematically here, so-called low field, medium, and high field regions. Low field is from zero to the end of the linear part. And arbitrary is the end of the high field is where the saturation is about 98%. And the, in between we have medium field, okay? It's just the first approach, just to compare different samples using the same conditions. And the next idea is how to calculate the density of the jumps. And so we use this example shows the used approach. Here we see two curves for 20 GPa on the 30 GPa samples acquired in the same magnetization region. And we see the total length, the total cumulative length of this curve is much less compared to this curve, okay? Here, this length is much, much higher. We just added the length of this, and this is our method, okay? And finally, here we see the effect of the shock pressure on the Barkhausen parameters, and we see it's not linear, and first we see the influence of the shock pressure on the development of the width of different magnetization regions, and we see, for example, here we have the higher sensitivity of the medium field range where we have more irreversible changes with the magnetic, with the orientation of the magnetic domains. And then we have degrees of the high field region because more energy was dissipated in the medium field, okay? Physically, it's, I think it's obvious. And here we have, with increasing pressure, as expected, we have degradation of the so-called reversible region, but we have slow, because due to the presence of shock defects, we have degradation of this region. And finally, if we relate the Barkhausen density to the width of the different region, we see here again that this medium field region looks more pronounced compared to another regions. Okay. We use also classical first order recovery curve distributions. And here we see this is a set of the sample. Here we say initial samples. We have very thin intensity parallel to this ordinate, and this is okay, you know, from literature. It's also typical for multi-domain particles. And with increasing of the pressure, we have the increasing distribution along this axis, so we have the higher coercitivities. And also, you can, if you compare very roughly with the results of Max Verdi, who studies the synthetic magnetite powders with different particle size, and it looks very similar, but in the in another way. Is it, you know? Okay, we see that, for example, this is the biggest particles, 11 micrometers, looks similar like this, while the smallest particle is similar to this pressure. And also, we can recognize that the higher the pressure, the higher the total area of this signal. And this is why we applied image J, we carry out image analysis, and we quantify the total area of the signal. We just use binarized images, the ratio of the, in this case, red to white. And here we see this is the ratio as a function of pressure. And we see, how to say, very pretty correlation between the applied pressure. Okay, so now wavy transition. Okay, wavy transition measured using copper bridge. And in this case, you know that from the, if you proceed from the low temperature to the high temperatures, actually this is done in experiment, we have transition from monoclinic to cubic structure, and initial samples has very nice, very nice transition, very sharp transition, around minus 151 degrees C, and correspond to the very nice stoichiometric builded magnetite. Find the literature very nice. Also correlates well with X-ray data. Okay, and then with increasing pressure, we have, again, we recognize a couple of effects. First of all, we see the drop of the susceptibility at the room temperature. Then we have the accompanying drops in the low temperature. We see a slight shift of the vapor resisting temperature. And as well, we see that with increasing temperature, we see the increasing inclinement of this transition, which actually is proportional to the width of the transition. Okay, and these all parameters are shown here. So here we see the lower temperature and room temperature susceptibility. And then we introduce a so-called T temperature. I call this just now T ratio, which is expressed like the difference between room and low temperature ratio divided by 100. And here we see this range is showed very interesting, all known correlation with the shock pressure. Again, a sharp drop to 10 GPa and then recovery starting from 20 GPa, again, the recovery effect. And also in this case, we see that the temperature of the transition changes not very drastically, while the width of the transition is more sensitive to the shock pressure. Again, this can recognize recovery effect. Okay, the next important question, we'd like to understand the so-called magnetic memory. And again, we carry out measurements of saturation remanent magnetization, which were increased, were obtained using high magnetic field. It means the samples were imparted, were saturating using 2.5 Tesla. And then the magnetization was measured as a function of the temperature in the vicinity of very transitions. And here we see the cooling curves. The sample was cooled down and then was reheated. And here we see very, very prominent points, M1, M3, etc. And again, the initial sample has a very typical for multi-domain magnetite behavior. Why? And we see here is we see what is the evolution of different so-called memory parameters. And we see the all parameters have the similar trends. The higher the pressure, the higher the magnetic memory. Okay, it's already known, but it's again the evidence that it also correlates with another mass. And again, we recognize if you look what is happening with this transition with this feature M5 and M3. Okay, you see this is a feature with it's again. At the high pressures, it appears again. It means we have some development. So, and here the development of this feature we called jump ratio, just the difference between the heights. Okay, and this that jump ratio is shown here. And we see the jump ratio again show this recovery trend. Okay, above the 10 GPa, we have again recovery. Here we have a very sharp drop. So it's also pressure sensitive. And generally, take it into account, you can take into account our, first of all, our data obtained by high resolution transmission microscopy showing the presence of lattice defect. So we can imagine that exactly these defects are responsible for the increasing magnetic memory, is increasing shock pressure. Another point of discussion about the possible shock temperature. We don't did some measurements. Actually, it's impossible to do this in the case of this recovery experiments. But we can compare very roughly our results with the results as usual published in the literature. And here we see the shock pressure calculated by Falco-Langenhorst for quartz targets, and if you remember, our samples is a quartz magnetite sample. Okay, that it's very close to the properties of the quartz. Here's the melting point of the quartz, and we see that the higher is the shock pressure, the higher the temperature. And for example, in the case of our maximum applied temperature, 30 GPa, we can have temperature about 1,300 degrees C. Another interesting result also presented by Ugalde at Kaunas, and here we see the shock pressure calculated for so-called diabase rock targets. And here we see the distribution of the temperatures, and here we see the distribution of pressures. And okay, if we compare with our data, we see again that our applied pressures have such temperature distribution, and it also correlates with data of Langenhorst. And finally, also in Ugalde, also here is an interesting correlation between the origin of magnetic anomalies and the obtained experiment obtained magnetic data and possible processes which occurred in the target, like melting, like degrees of magnetic resetting, shown here, like remanence demagnetization, like recrystallization. And you, if you see that here, we see very similar reagents, okay? For example, we have also found that around 10 GPa, we have susceptibility degrees. Then we have, at the higher pressures, we have very prominent remanence demagnetization. And finally, at the higher temperature, which is higher as the Curie temperature, now okay, we have a higher shock temperatures. We have totally very, very prominent magnetic resetting, and we also found presence of recrystallization phenomenon in form of twin lamella. So I came slowly to conclusion, and so we see that actually we need to combine different methods. Namely, we should combine non-magnetic structural methods with magnetic methods in order to be able to make some estimations of pressures, so-called geobarometers. Maybe in this case we should consider so-called temperature-assisted pressures, not like what obtained in static experiments indicate temperature-assisted pressures. And we see we have evidences directly obtained by microscopy. We see the presence of deformation structures, and we see a lot of changes in magnetic behavior. And this also can be taken into account in order to understand possible impact-induced target demagnetization. And for first approach, we can have two approaches. The first one, we have pure so-called mechanical fragmentation. But in the real case, what we see is that this fragmentation is also accompanied by defect accumulation with increasing pressure. And here we see a possible reasons of impacting to again target remagnetization or recovery processes. We see the his schematic is shown that with increasing shock, we have the increasing shock temperature. And this shock temperature provokes recovery process. Okay. Fine. So now the next step, as usual, we'd like to check whether the found correlationships can be applied for real complex natural conditions. And now we'd like to study dolerites, shock dolerites from local impact crater from Sweden. We will compare samples obtained from different impacted areas. Then we also like to apply additional shock to the relatively less shock sample to see whether it will be possible to introduce an additional shock-induced defects and demagnetization. So, and I would like to thank a lot for your attention.